Heavenly Father, thank you again for the meal that you provided, and we pray now that the meal you have for us now, looking at your word and your creation, that we would just be nourished and strengthened by it as well. So speak to us now, in Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you. Boy, that is the easiest clap I ever gotten. So, some of you may have seen some of these things before, but it has been a long time, and we've added a lot of stuff. I am going to have to skip a lot of things, because if I do the full version of this, it's over 3 hours of this presentation. So there is a DVD of it. I'm not trying to sell DVDs, but I do want you to get the information. And because of that, we are... Our DVDs, if it's Brian Young, you get 50% off of them, okay? So it'll give you a 3-hour and 15-minute DVD for $10. So you'll get your money's worth. But what I want to do is just give you kind of a nutshell version in case you won't be able to hear some of these things. To answer the most common questions I get in the area of dinosaurs and, you know, just the typical arc questions, things like that. To understand this, you need to understand what the Bible calls a firmament. Now, I want you to understand that I am not dogmatic on a firmament theory. Answers in Genesis is not keen on a firmament. There are people who work at Answers in Genesis who like a firmament theory. So just be aware of that. The Bible gives us some clues, but it doesn't tell us all the details, so we have to make some assumptions ourselves as far as what things may have been like, and so I'm not going to make a doctrine on that, okay? But I do like the canopy theory because it seems to answer all the things that are out there. And what is the canopy or firmament theory? It is this. In Genesis 1, 6 through 7, we see that God creates, he separates the waters, dividing the waters which were, you know, above the firmament from those were underneath, and he also separates it horizontally, creating dry land and water. Single dry land mass, so I do believe in Pangaea, that single land continent. Well, when he separates that, he also, the vertical separation, this word firmament here is rakia in Hebrew. Now, there are a lot of people who have believed in this firmament. Almost everybody in the past, actually, or all the early church fathers. It may have looked something like this here with the continent, or the earth, and then the firmament being up around the top of it. If you dissect the earth in half, you'd have the firmament, the crust of the earth, waters underneath. All right? So, just an idea. Some people wonder, how could it be held up? Well, maybe through superconductive material. In our creation camps, we take this superconductive material, and we superfreeze it with liquid nitrogen. And when you do so, it hovers above a magnet. Now, it's not magnetism. It's completely different. You can actually take this and put it upside down. You can stick it on a track, and it goes around the track. You can put the track upside down, and the magnet or the superconductive material will go around the track upside down. So, I don't know. It's just a scientific possibility, but we don't know. The Earth is like a big magnet. Now, this firmament, Josephus says it was there. The Jewish rabbis say that before the flood, that the Earth, the atmosphere was different to allow people to live longer and so on. So, again, there are people who support it. The thing that I want to show you, though, is that with that canopy there, it would be a different world to live in. First of all, we'd have more air pressure. NASA's measured atmospheric gases 200 miles into outer space, and they would have been compressed underneath this canopy. We would also have more oxygen. We would have no rain, because high and low air pressure systems could not form, which would not allow clouds to form. Now, the Bible says there was no rain and indicates that. In Genesis 2:5, it says the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the earth. Well, how did everything get watered? Well, if you look at verse 6 there, it says streams came up from the earth and watered the whole surface of the ground. That is the exact picture we see in the Garden of Eden, where in the garden there's a huge aquifer bubbling up from the center, and from it four rivers break off. So waters were coming up from underneath the ground, watering everything. Now, you'd also have a tropical paradise because it would be like a greenhouse. What I have just told you now, evolutionists agree with. They will tell you that millions of years ago we had a tropical paradise at the time of the dinosaurs. They will tell you that there was no rain for millions of years on this earth, you know, when the earth was forming, and then later oceans formed. They will tell you we had more air pressure and oxygen in the past. The only difference is the timing and the cause. They're saying millions of years, I'm saying a few thousand, and they don't know why. Now, we also believe that it would protect us from the solar radiation of the sun. That water filters out the shortwave radiation, so you'd be protected from sunburns and a lot of diseases that come from the sun today, for the radiation. Well, how do we know that there was more oxygen? Why do they say that? Because we find fossilized amber, which is simply tree sap that rolled down the side of a tree. As it did, it captured the atmosphere in these air bubbles. We measure what's inside those air bubbles, and we see more oxygen. So, that's why they say it. Again, the question is, well, when was this? All right. When did it get buried? When Noah's flood comes, however, the world changes. We see in Genesis 7, it says that on that day, all the springs of the great deep burst forth. What springs? Well, the waters that were underneath the ground are bubbling up, watering everything. And then it says the floodgates of heaven, the Hebrew is like a dam breaking. The waters above now came down. So the floodwaters have two sources. The waters underneath are now coming up, and the waters that were above are now coming down. Okay? It might look something like this, where you have the continent splitting, water shooting up into the sky, causing plate tectonics. Now, I do believe in plate tectonics. I think Noah's flood caused it just a few thousand years ago. And there's great science to support that, but we're not going to get into that today. Now, another question I want to ask is, where did all the water go? Because this is what so many liberal theologians are doing. In our Christian universities, they're saying, well, you can't believe Noah's flood was a global flood because there's not enough water on Earth to cover the highest mountain by 20 feet. And if you tell people that, you're going to sound scientifically ridiculous, and they're not going to listen to you when you talk about the gospel. So please, don't tell people you believe Noah's flood covered the whole Earth. Well, I say, if the Bible says it, I believe it. And you go read the account, there's no question it was a global flood. And the other ironic thing is they're telling me that there was a global flood on the planet Mars. Now, how much water has been found on Mars? None. But yet they're telling me that I can't have a global flood on a planet that has 70% water on it, but they can have one on a planet that doesn't have any. Doesn't it sound like there's a bias here? Yeah. And by the way, we do believe that there was water on Mars. First of all, here's some proof of it, but... okay. But actually, we do believe there's water on Mars, was water on Mars. Because if the Earth started out as water, like the Bible says, why wouldn't the other planets? Dr. Russell Humphreys did some interesting research. He has a creation model of the universe. Back in the 1970s, they sent a probe to Uranus and Neptune, and they measured the electromagnetic fields, the nitrogen levels, and so on, of these planets. In 2012, another probe went back. And so they were all excited because they were going to be able to compare what the readings were in 1974 to what they are in 2012. Well, based on evolution, you know, you're not going to have much of a change and whatnot. So NASA gave their predictions. Dr. Russell Humphreys, using a creation model, gave his predictions. Do you know that NASA wasn't even in the same ballpark? But Dr. Russell Humphreys was only 1.8% off, suggesting that these planets started as water. So we do believe it. I'm just trying to point out the inconsistency is that, hey, if you can have one, we can too. A global flood, right? Now, other things we need to look at. If this was just a local flood, like some of these liberal theologians are saying, how can a local flood cover the highest mountain by 20 feet? The waters are going to go down into the valleys and fill the valleys before, you know, it's no longer local. If it was just a local flood, why didn't God say, hey, Noah, move? Why did he take birds on the ark if they could have flown to the next dry hillside? And the rainbow God put in the sky saying, I'm never going to do such a thing again. Wouldn't that make God a liar? Mm-hmm. This has to be a global flood. And do you know that if you look at the scriptures, it tells us where the waters went? Psalm 104, verses 6 through 9, tells us that the waters stood above the mountains. The mountains rose up and the valleys sank down, and God set a boundary those waters should never pass again. Doesn't that sound like plate tectonics? Yeah. It seems that God used the continents running into each other, raising up the mountains to get rid of the floodwaters as the ocean valleys sank down. Now, evolutionists and liberal theologians try and get around this more so by saying this. This isn't talking about the flood. This is talking about creation. The problem is, in the same chapter, they're talking about the ships of Lebanon and never doing it again. So this cannot be talking about creation. This is the flood, and there's no question about it. Did you know that if you would level the earth out so that the mountains weren't as high and the oceans weren't as deep, that right now on earth there's enough water to cover the entire thing by almost 2 miles of water? Plenty of water on earth to have a global flood. So scientifically, this is not crazy at all. And even if it was, the Bible says it, I believe it. But it's not. How about this? Where did all the races come from? How many races are there? That's right, one. And if you thought there was more, I'll fix that for you. You see, the Tower of Babel explains this. When you go to Russia today, you know what people look like over there? Russians. When you go to China, you know what they look like? Chinese. You know, when you go to America, though, what do we look like? Who knows? There's not an American look. I can't look at any of you and say, hey, you're American. Because you see, we are the melting pot, and the gene pool has been mixed up. But when you isolate gene pools so the genetic pool isn't mixed up, you get dominant physical features like Russia and Africa and China and whatnot. The Tower of Babel did just that. It isolated gene pools as God confused their languages. Small groups of people went to different areas, isolating the gene pools, and you get dominant physical features coming about. Now, to prove this to you, here are twins born from white parents. DNA proves they are the parents. One twin is white, one is black. If we are a different race, how could this be possible? Wouldn't be. And all of these are the same thing happening. Black people can have white kids too. This is just genetics. All it is that this child has more melanin in his skin than that one. We all have a skin pigment called melanin. The more you have, the darker you are. The less you have, the lighter you are. It's that simple. But just because some of you have more hair than others in this room, we don't need to talk about who, it doesn't mean that you're more or closer to a monkey than I am because you have more hair than I do. Just because somebody has more melanin than another doesn't mean they're a different race of people, does it? No. So we are all one race, the human race, and the Bible tells us that God hath made of one blood all nations of men. Very simple. Now, gets interesting here. How could people live to be 900 years old before Noah's flood? A lot of ideas out there. Some say, well, they counted time differently back then. Well, like we talked about in the service this morning, no. The sun, moon, and stars are, you know, were created for signs, times, and seasons. The solar calendar is just as accurate back then as it is today. And besides, you know, they say, well, maybe each day was a month long. Well, then Enoch had a baby when he was 5. Doesn't answer the question. How could people truly live 900 plus years before the flood, because that's what they're doing, and then the flood comes, and it changes immediately. Now, you can't count that guy. That's Enoch. He went to heaven alive. All right? Well, one of the things is, I believe, this solar radiation. You see, when the radiation of the sun, we are protected from it, from that firmament. Well, after the flood, that firmament comes down, and now the radiation of the sun goes, and it screws up the gene pool. I mean, look at you guys. You're a mess. And so am I. We're all a mess because of that radiation from the sun. It's a fact. That could explain why this village in Ecuador, 25% of their population lived to be over 100 years of age. 25%. But they live in a deep ravine that receives very little sunlight every day, so the sun comes up later, goes down sooner. But they're living longer. That also might explain here why these kids were famous. This picture was taken from a Canadian newspaper from the 1950s. These kids became famous because their parents kept them indoors for 11 years, would not allow them to go outside during the day. Social services got wind of this. They came in and they took the children away from the parents. Doctors examined them and found them to be healthy except for one problem, the age of these kids. This little girl, she's 13 years old, the boy is 15, and the older girl, 18 years old. None of them had gone through puberty yet. Doctors didn't know why. I can't tell you why. All I can say is it's interesting that they were kept out of the sun for 11 years. Okay? I can tell you this, though. If any of you like to get a good suntan in the summer, you might think you look good now, but you might look like this when you get to be 40. It is a scientific fact that the sun will cause you to age and wrinkle up faster. No question about it. You go to Australia, you'll see that people over there look older than what they really are because of that intense radiation, a hole in the ozone thing. So we know the sun has something to do with us not being able to live as long. Over 60 known diseases are caused today by the sun's radiation. And people are always asking me, where did Cain get his wife? Cain married his sister because he was able. It's that simple. You see, Adam and Eve had a pure genetic pool. They were created perfect. Today, a brother and a sister, we don't have pure gene pools. So if a brother and a sister would get married, you multiply the genetic mistakes, and so your children come out funny. And I don't mean comedians. It's bad. But if you have a pure gene pool when you get have children together, it's not a problem. It's not until the book of Leviticus, long after Noah's flood, that God steps in and says no more incest, because by that time the gene pool had been corrupted from the radiation. And so, and even then, by the way, it wasn't a sin. He said, just don't do it. So, it's not an issue. Well, we have bones of Neanderthal, this beetle-browed, bow-legged, hunched-over guy in the fossil record they used to say was a missing link. Now they say he was completely human, but bottom line is, what I'm going to show you with this, you know old people, you get big ears, okay? You know why? Because your ears never stop growing, nor does your brow ridge. And it's interesting that they have a big brow ridge. Never stops growing. It seems like these guys were living longer. Not only that, but we've sent creationists around the world examining the skulls of Neanderthal, and in every case, they've been put together incorrectly. They have cheated on the angle of the jaw to make it look more childlike, because it's a child-sized skull. But the wear on the teeth and the angle of the jaw say it's an adult. Well, what's an adult doing looking like a child? Well, think about it. I mean, some of you older people here, you know who you are. If God came to you and said, I'm going to let you live another 100 years, what would you say? No, God, please, no. Not in these bodies. That'd be a curse. And here is fossil evidence suggesting that they were living longer. Because if you're going to live to be 900, you would expect you would need to mature at a slower rate, wouldn't you? The fossils support that, just like the Bible says. Even the Chinese say people used to live to be 1,000 years of age. Now, the Ice Age is also important. I believe in the Ice Age. There was only one of them. And it only came down about a third of the way down the United States. A lot of people think it covered the whole world. No, it just came down a third of the way. That's it. Okay? But we have the best scientific explanation for the Ice Age as Bible-believing Christians. By far the best scientific explanation. When volcanoes go off, they put gases into the atmosphere. Those gases are what cause colder climates. That's a scientific fact. We have observed that. There was a volcano called Tambora in 1815. When this thing erupted, it gave us 2 years without summer in America, even though that was in Indonesia. Because volcanoes give colder climates. Our textbooks tell us this. Now, interestingly, we have found a lost squadron of airplanes that landed on the glaciers in World War II. We found them 48 years later, though, but they were under 263 feet of ice. They found them using sonar. Now, interestingly, the deepest ice we have in the world is in Greenland. There's 10,000 feet deep. It's a mountain of ice. They've actually taken a core sample of it and counted the layers, and they counted 135,000 layers of ice about. So they say that ice age is about 135,000 years old. Because, as our textbooks tell us, every year a layer of ice forms on average. So, if I have 48 years of ice on top of those airplanes, how many layers of ice should I find? About 48. Tough math, huh? Well, interestingly, because when they melted the hole down to get to those airplanes, you could see the layers. There was almost 1,000 layers of ice there. You know what that tells me about how they count ice? By counting layers? It's wrong. It doesn't work. Instead, what we see in observational science is 5.5 feet of ice on average accumulated on top of this airplane every year. If you take that rate of accumulation, apply that to the 10,000 feet of ice we have in Greenland, allow for the compression rates, it puts the ice age at 4,400 years ago. That's almost exactly when Noah's flood is getting over, supporting the fact that the flood caused the ice age. Now here's another interesting thing. What would our world be like if we had more oxygen and air pressure like I proposed it did there in the past? Well, we can tell through what are called hyperbaric chambers. My correspondent for this was Dr. William Fife at Texas A&M. They did more research on this than anywhere else in the world. He said, on average, if you go into one of these things, you will heal in half the time. It's a room or a tube that you go into where they increase the oxygen and the air pressure. And he said the perfect setting is to have 25 to 28% oxygen and twice the atmospheric pressure. That is exactly what we predict the pre-flood world was like. I was interested. Not only do you heal in half the time, but one woman was bit by a tick when she was 6 years old. At the age of 16, she was confined to a wheelchair. Her head hung down. She could hardly lift it up on her own. She was so weak. After 2.5 months of treatment with Dr. Fife, she was able to get up out of her wheelchair, walk short distances, even rode a horse. Another man, legally dead due to carbon monoxide poisoning. Legally dead, but he was an organ donor, so they wanted to give his organs to somebody else. So they wheeled him and his life support system into the chamber. And then 3 days later, they were going to, you know, give his organs to somebody else, but they couldn't because he walked out of the hospital completely recovered, with complete memory. And this is the kind of world we may have lived in the pre-flood atmosphere. Now, I don't want to give you the idea that this is a miracle cure for everything. It isn't. But miraculous things do take place in it. I've got access to one of these things. I got stung by a bee on a Saturday afternoon. I swelled up Saturday night. I looked like Popeye on one arm. And Sunday morning, I couldn't even bend my arm to shake people's hands. It was just all swollen up. Well, after church, I had jumped into one of these chambers for 45 minutes. By 7 o'clock Sunday night, all the swelling was gone, had full motion. I didn't have to go through that itchy stage that I normally do about 5 days later and all of that, because I normally stay swollen up for 5 days, and everything was fine. Just like 3 weeks ago, I got stung 16 times. And yeah, my suit had a few holes in it. So I got stung 16 times. I thought, oh, this is going to stink. And so I went into the hyperbaric chamber, and everything was good. I didn't have to go through anything like that either. So, again, amazing things do take place. Almost every professional sports team has these now today, because you heal in half the time. Just about every one of them. Well, how about plants? What would it be like for plants in this kind of environment? Well, a guy named Kei Mori at Keio University in Tokyo, Japan, did an interesting study. He wanted to maximize the potential of a cherry tomato plant. So what he did is he stuck the plant into the chamber where he doubled the air pressure, got rid of the harmful effects of the sun through fiber optics, inadvertently recreating what we believe the pre-flood world was like. 2 years later, he has a cherry tomato plant that's still alive. Not only is it 2 years old, but it was 14 feet tall. Had 903 tomatoes on it, baseball to grapefruit size. But that's nothing. You see, Kei Mori passed away in 1993. The plant is still alive today. It is over 50 years old, over 40 feet tall, has over 15,000 tomatoes on it. And this is the kind of world that we may have lived in the pre-flood atmosphere. Because do you know that you go to the museums and they're telling you you have all this lush vegetation, like I said, right? Why? They don't know. Can I make a suggestion? We lived in a greenhouse. The fossils we see, do you know that plants that today are 18 inches tall are 120 feet tall in the fossil record? The vegetation we find in the fossil record would blow your mind. It's amazing. But they can't tell you why it was that way. But the Bible gives an indication of possibly why. I don't know if you've ever seen a calf puller before. I suspect some of you have here. When a cow is having a baby and they can't get the baby out, They stick this thing here on the rear end of the mother. Cable goes down, ties to the feet of the calf sticking out of the mother, and that's a jack. And they just as fast as they can. It's where you women can be glad you're not cows. One day there was a farmer pulling a calf with one of these things. A city guy was driving along, and he thought, what is that guy doing to that cow? So he pulls alongside of the road to watch. Well, the farmer invites him over, thinking this ought to be good. So he hops the fence, he comes over there, and the farmer says, you've never seen this, huh? He says, never in my life. He said, well, do you have any questions? He said, yeah. How fast do you think that calf had to have been going when it ran into the back of that thing? Same evidence, but two very different ways of interpreting that evidence, isn't it? And this is the very heart of the creation-evolution debate. I live on the same earth that the evolutionists do. I have the same scientific data they do. The data is not the problem. It's the interpretation of the data. That's the problem. For example, we find baleen whales in the deserts of Chile or shark's teeth in Nebraska. What are they doing in deserts? Well, an evolutionist has to take that data and now you have to interpret it, don't you? Every piece of scientific data has to be interpreted. An evolutionist looks at that and they say, well, I don't believe in the Bible and Noah's flood. Therefore, we think the oceans have been moving around. I look at that and I say, well, that sounds just like what Noah's flood would do. See, the data's not the problem, is it? Now, my interpretation fits the evidence better, as we'll talk about coming up. But we find coal 200 feet thick throughout the Midwest. That would take 2,000 feet of vegetation. So they say it takes millions of years for coal to form. Because you need millions of years of plants growing and dying, growing and dying, growing and dying, piling on top of it to, you know, be able to be compressed into that much coal. Take that much time to accumulate that. Well, if you've ever been in a local flood, it carries the vegetation to general places and leaves it there, doesn't it? Likewise, Noah's flood would take this huge vegetation we see in the fossil record, carry it to general places, and leave it there. A continent come over top, or just get buried in flood sediments, and you would have coal in a very short period of time. If it took coal millions of years to form, why did we find a bell with a pagan god on it in coal? Shouldn't happen. We can make coal in a lab, like I said, in 20 minutes. All you need is conditions Noah's flood provided naturally. It doesn't take millions of years. It doesn't take long periods for fossils to form either. Here's a felt hat, now a hard hat in less than 100 years. Really, less than 50 years. Or look at this, a Mexican pillar dollar encased in rock. Or a limestone dollar bill found in Wyoming. Does not take long periods for rocks and fossils to form. Here's a fossilized teddy bear in 2 weeks. We've got one of these for our museum. A rose in 5 days. You just need mineral-rich water, something Noah's flood churning up the earth would produce. Cowboy leg fossilized in the cowboy boot. The boot manufacturers say the boot was made in about 1950. So we know fossils can form in less than that amount of time. Or here, we see a fish giving birth in the fossil record. That's how fast you have to get buried to turn into a fossil. So fast you don't even have time to swallow. Here's a little one getting eaten by a big one. Or it could be a dentist. It depends on your interpretation. Okay. You see, you don't just die and become a fossil. You need a lot of water and a lot of mud to turn you into a fossil. And the idea of these things dying in the lake, look in the newspaper. Anytime they find the so-called missing link fossil, what do they say? It's always, it died, fell in a lake, fell to the bottom, maybe a volcano blew up and buried it. They know they need to get this thing buried, removed from the oxygen in about a 30-second period of time, or you don't fossilize typically. Gee, what would give us that lot of water, lot of mud? Do you think Noah's flood might do that? You bet. It is the best explanation for what we see in the fossil record. Fossils laid down by water, sedimentary rock, all over the earth. Yeah. Here's a petrified dog and a petrified tree. That gives new meaning to the word tree bark, doesn't it? Lots of things like this. We could go on and on. How about the dinosaurs, though? What happened to the dinosaurs? All kinds of theories out there. I took a graduate course to learn this. I'm going to give it to you for free because it's all it was worth. They told me a new plant began to evolve. The dinosaurs started eating the plant, caused them to become constipated so they couldn't go to the bathroom anymore and died. Not the best way to go. Or not go. And then there was a tight short theory, they called it, where the climate became too warm, the males became sterile, couldn't reproduce. Well, you probably heard about this one. The meteorite came crashing into the earth, causing a big dust storm to block out the sun. They don't believe that anymore. Now they actually say the meteorite hit the oceans, causing a big tidal wave to come in on land and bury them in water and mud. That's why in my book, Doubts About Creation, Not After This, I have many quotes of evolutionists saying, local floods buried these dinosaurs. You always hear it, local floods, local floods. They can't admit Noah's flood because that would mean God's word is true and we're not going there. Some say that they didn't have enough food to eat. Others say too much food to eat. Still others say the wrong kind of food to eat. Gave them bad gas. That took care of the problem. I'm not joking. I paid money to learn that burping and farting dinosaurs is what happened to them. It shouldn't surprise us, though. Because, I mean, you ranchers and whatnot, you know, you've heard about all the methane gases, you know. I'd like to see Michelle Obama getting on Disney Channel talking about that one. Please, ranchers, you know, get your cows some gas sex. Go green. But this is what we have to stoop to explain what's already explained in Scripture. We'll come back to this here, but the theory that has won out is this. Dinosaurs didn't go extinct, they turned into birds. Never mind the fact we have no evidence of this. None at all. None. But yet in our museums we have these feathered dinosaurs. It's crazy. You know what? I have a shortened version of this opened up. I feel like I want to show you this, so I'm going to be obedient and show it to you. Let me open something else up to show you in connection to this. There is not any evidence in the world showing us dinosaurs had feathers. Now, there's going to be some that are going to say, oh, yes, there is. We've got Archaeopteryx. But Archaeopteryx is a bird, and many evolutionists even say that. Okay? It's just that it's interpreted as a missing link because it has claws on the end of its wings. Well, not really claws, a bony structure on the end of its wing. Well, so does an ostrich today, an eagle, a Hawatzin. Even a chicken has a bony claw on the end of its wing. So it's not anything but a bird. But yet in the museums, we keep having things like this there. Okay, well, I want to show you why you're seeing this, these feathered dinosaurs, okay? Here's an article just from a year ago. It says this, for the last 20 years, huge numbers of fossils from China have dramatically demonstrated that large numbers of dinosaur species that were closely related to the birds, okay, had all manner of feathers. Now, what I want you to note, this is everything I'm showing you is from the same article. What I want you to note is either a third grader wrote this article, or there's a lot of propaganda going on. Because notice, they had all manner of feathers on their bodies. Now, one of the things they're referring to is Archaeopteryx. Okay, the thing I just told you that's just a full bird. That's all it is, but it had claws on its wing. I keep saying claw, a bony point on the end of its wing. Anyway, it says, and it goes on, that in science suggests that, in fact, feathers they had, or at least very feather-like structures. Now, did you catch that switch? They had, in fact, feathers, or at least feather-like structures. Okay? You see that turnaround? It goes on, and it says, just because we have, say, some skin from the legs doesn't mean there were not feathers elsewhere on the body. In other words, we found skin. It was covered in skin. Okay? It says, the possibility remains that many species had feathers, but the evidence is just lacking at the moment. Okay? In some cases, this is a reasonable inference. Since, for example, several T-Rexes are known with feathers, strongly implying that even T-Rex had them. What? Did you just tell me that we know T-Rex had them, but it implies they had them? Which is it? Did they or did they not? That tells you that we are trying to make something out of the evidence, not letting the evidence speak for itself. It goes on. What we don't tend to see are more complex structures of filaments with multiple strands that are in part characteristic of later feathers. Oh, wait a minute. You've been telling me you found feathers, but what we're seeing is we don't really find feathers. We just think things that could be developing feathers. All right? And it says, and the relationship between scales and feathers. In other words, we have no idea how that happened. It goes on, most of the fossils were juveniles, which suggests that they died in single events, not in mass catastrophe. Let me read between the lines there. Not Noah's flood, you Bible-believing Christians. It was a single events. Many local floods, not the global one that you guys are going to think about. And it goes on. It says the plant-eating dinosaurs likely died and fell to the lake bottom. Remember I said that's what they say all the time? They fall to... You know what today when things die in lakes and oceans, you know what happens to them? They get eaten up and scavenged by other animals. They don't fall to the bottom and fossilize. So it doesn't even fit what we observe today. And it goes on, but the new Siberian fossils are the best example yet that some of these beaked dinosaurs had feathers. All right, so do you want to see the best evidence yet that dinosaurs had feathers? All right, prepare yourself because it's amazing. Here it is. Right there. See those little lines that don't look anything like a feather? That is the best, and that's why you have all these feathered dinosaurs in our museums. Here's what the rest of it looks like. Skin. Scales. Okay? It's silly, but this is what they're doing. Again, evidence must be interpreted, and it's a worldview that is causing that interpretation. So, I'm going to skip some things. Like I said, I kind of opened up the long one now, so now I'm really going to start skipping things. But anyway, bottom line is, here's Nebraska Man, the first Cornhusker. They found one tooth, and this is what they put in our museums. Isn't science amazing? I don't know. Later, they found the rest of the bones belonged to the tooth. It was a pig. But notice they put whites in the eyes. This was the evidence used in the 1925 Scopes trial. Now, by the way, what's interesting about that is this. At that time, the theologians were saying, whoa, look, how can you argue with this? We need science to help us understand the Bible. Kind of like what I was telling you this morning. Now, do you know that today, every piece of evidence that was used to support evolution in the Scopes trial has been proven incorrect? Rather than saying, boy, we're never going to do that again, we still continue to do the same thing. And now we have Lucy today. Notice whites in the eyes again. Monkeys and apes don't have whites in their eyes. Human hands and feet they put on her, even though they did not find hand and feet bones. They only found 40% of her skeleton. Later we found another one of these. They found some hand and foot bones, and so they were chimpanzee hands and feet. We went and asked them, why do you have human hands and feet on Lucy? When it was proven they were chimpanzee hands and feet, here's their answer. We can't change these exhibits every time new information comes about. Besides, we believe it portrays the information we're trying to get across. And what might that be? The lie of evolution. It's that simple. The knee joint was found 1.5 miles away, 200 feet deeper than the rest of the bones. You call that good science? To find something 1.5 miles away, 200 feet deeper? Oh, I bet that belongs with these over here. That's bad science. Even some honest evolutionist says, you can't do that. So they needed something else to get her to walk in an upright position. What did they do? The hip joint. Watch this video from David Menton on a DVD we have back there called Lucy, She's No Lady, which is really a clip off of PBS Nova. Watch this.
They're supposed to be human-like hips, so you can walk the way the Latoli footprints showed she walked. But they don't look like human hips, they look like ape hips. What to do about this? Watch it. You'll get a big kick out of this.
The ape that stood up, it was a revolutionary idea. We needed Owen Lovejoy's expertise again, because the evidence wasn't quite adding up The knee looked human, but the shape of her hip didn't. Superficially, her hip resembled a chimpanzee's, which meant that Lucy couldn't possibly have walked like a modern human. But Lovejoy noticed something odd about the way the bones had been fossilized.
When I put the two parts of the pelvis together that we had, this part of the pelvis has pressed so hard and so completely into this one that it caused it to be broken into a series of individual pieces which were then fused together in later fossils.
So you see, they were broken and they don't fit together properly. They did speculate in the program as to exactly who was responsible for breaking the hip, and current scientific evidence suggests perhaps a deer stepped on it. Here you can see a deer foot stepping on the bone. Isn't that a bummer? Let's see where it goes from here.
This has caused the two bones, in fact, to fit together so well they're in an anatomically impossible position.
The perfect fit was an illusion that made Lucy's hip bone seem to flare out like a chimp's. But all was not lost.
This is a power saw, friends. You may want to put your goggles on.
Lovejoy decided he could restore the pelvis to its natural shape. He didn't want to tamper with the original, so he made a copy in plaster.
Notice he's removing whole parts, not just cutting.
He cut the damaged pieces out and put them back together the way they were before Lucy died. It was a tricky job, but after taking the kink out of the pelvis, it all fit together perfectly, like a three-dimensional jigsaw puzzle.
Look how perfect! You can read a newspaper through the hole.
As a result, the angle of the hip looks nothing like a chimp's, but a lot like ours.
That's what we call science, guys. That's not science, is it? That's making the evidence fit what your worldview is. It's that simple. And so, I mean, you saw at the beginning it said, superficially, Lucy's hip looked like a chimpanzee. At the end, as a result, it looks nothing like a chimp's, but a lot like ours. Well, no kidding. You give me some Play-Doh, I can make it do that too. That's not science. Like I said, whites in the eyes, monkeys and apes don't have that. We've owned monkeys. We brought them up to Lutheran Island Camp. As a matter of fact, you kids in the summer, you sign up. We do a creation camp up there at Lutheran Island Camp. Just call them and talk about, you just ask them about, you know, the creation camp where we would do all kinds of scientific stuff, and we brought the monkeys up, let them play with the monkeys and all those kind of things. But the bottom line is they don't have whites in their eyes. But our children's books sometimes put whites in the eyes because this gives it a human characteristic. So you got to watch for that because this is all propaganda. And here's Lucy's skull that they often show you in our museums. That's not Lucy's skull. This is Lucy's skull. Only the dark bones were found. That gives you a lot of freedom, doesn't it? A lot of interpretation needed to go into that. I'll tell you what, if these people could do what they're claiming they could do, we ought to make and hire them as our CSI teams. Can you imagine the murders they could solve? I mean, really. But somehow society has placed these people up as almost as if they're a god. And they know all these things when in fact they know nothing. It's all imagination and art and worldviews based on very little evidence. Well, let's get to the dinosaurs again here. What happened to them? All kinds of theories out there. Some say that they had lack of breathing or breathing issues because, you see, these larger ones like Seismosaurus and T-Rex have large bodies but small rib cages. If you have a small rib cage, you have a small heart and lung. They also had a nostril the size of a horse. So if you have a nostril the size of a horse, a small rib cage, they say, and a small lung then, they say a new theory, lack of oxygen killed the dinosaurs, not an asteroid. Couldn't breathe. But if we had more oxygen, more air pressure, more recent past, like I proposed we did, problem solved. And same thing for the pterodactyls and pteranodons who had wingspans and F4 Phantom jet airplane. The legs suggest they barely could walk, let alone run the great speeds they'd have to get up into the air. Well, twice the atmospheric pressure, more recent past would allow them to fly in a slight breeze. Problem solved. We also have things, well, I'm not going to talk about this one here. Save some time, give you some more answers. When did God make T-Rex? Any ideas? Lots of ideas out there. I'll tell you what, it's pretty simple if we just think biblically, isn't it? God says that, you know, well, I would say anyway, that T-Rex is an animal that lived on land, right? A land animal. The Bible says that land animals were made on the sixth day of creation, about 6,000 years ago. So I would say that means that T-Rex was made on day six of creation, about 6,000 years ago. Pretty simple. Are dinosaurs in the Bible? Yes and no. Well, you're both right. The word dinosaur is not in the Bible for the same reason the word email is not there. That word didn't exist when the Bible was translated into English in 1600. Okay? In 1600, it was translated into the King James Version. Then, we didn't even find the bones of dinosaurs until 1830. Didn't know what to call those bones until 1841 when the word dinosaur was invented. So no wonder you don't find them there. But you do find them, I think, under their real names. Job 39 talks about a unicorn. Now, I know you think a unicorn, you think of a horse with a horn, right? But we've never found that in the fossil record either. Is it possible that a unicorn is simply a creature with one horn, like we have found in the fossil record? Now, by the way, this is King James again. Now, I like the King James Version. I'm not a King James only guy by any means, but I like the King James because, first of all, a lot of the contradictions that are there are cleared up if you go to the King James. It's taken from the Textus Receptus, a different text almost, completely really. And so, if there's a question, I always go to the King James. So the problem is many of these modern translations have changed things to be more, well, historical criticism or scientific criticism, you might say, as you're going to see. But I think maybe a unicorn is one of these creatures. How about Job 40, the next chapter, starting at verse 15, going to the very end of the chapter, you've got this amazing creature they call Behemoth, which God made with you, day six of creation, same day he made man. It says that he feeds on grass like an ox. He has bones like tubes of bronze, limbs like rods of iron, power in his belly. What could this be? Well, I'm thankful for the footnotes at the bottom of the Bible. It tells us what it is. It's possibly an elephant or a hippopotamus. Keep in mind, footnotes were not inspired by God. I'd love to meet the man that wrote this footnote because I've got one question for him. Have you ever seen the tail of an elephant? It's not a cedar tree. Okay, it's more like a toothpick. And the hippo? Yeah, that sure took care of the problem, didn't it? Yeah, they don't have a tail like a cedar tree either. With this kind of reasoning, Behemoth had a big belly. I'm surprised this hasn't shown up in the footnotes, you know? No. The only animal that fits, and it fits perfect in every detail, is a dinosaur. Some say, well, maybe it's an alligator. Well, they don't eat grass like an ox. Only the dinosaur fits, and it fits perfectly in every detail. How about the next chapter, Job 41? The whole chapter talks about this great creature called Leviathan. It says the doors of his mouth are ringed about with fearsome teeth. His back has rows of shields tightly sealed together. Each is so close to the next that not even air can pass between them. Here it is. The fire shoots out of his mouth. Sparks of fire shoot out. Smoke pours from his nostrils as from a boiling pot over a fire. His chest is as hard as a rock, so a spear, a dart, a javelin doesn't bother him at all. What could this be? Well, I'm thankful for the footnotes again, right? Yeah, don't even bother. I mean, look at me. Do you guys really think that there was an animal out there that if it was threatened by something, could go and blow fire like that? I don't know what you put in that potluck, but... Really? Blowing fire? Well, do you know that still alive today in Africa, we've got this amazing creature here called the bombardier beetle, and it can shoot out its back end a noxious gas at over 212 degrees Fahrenheit, never missing its target? It's amazing. Yeah. It's got complex chemicals and enzymes mixed in separate storage chambers. I know some of you think you guys can do it too, but it's a different process, okay? Yeah. Yeah. This thing is amazing because these separate storage chambers here, chemicals and enzymes, mix it together in a combustion tube. It meets the oxygen in the air and poof, it goes off. Never missing. Pretty incredible. But how in the world could something like this evolve, first of all, slowly over millions of years? What if the pieces weren't, you know, made quite yet, or if your combustion tube hadn't formed? Chemicals were mixed wrong. And the poor beetle goes, oh, I wonder what happens when I do this? I can tell you what will happen. Evolution starts over. Okay? This is the way everything is. You know, the whole idea of evolution is survival of the fittest. If you don't have all your pieces, folks, you're not fit. It's the very opposite. So it doesn't even make sense that way. It fits with dinosaurs because we have in the fossil record these bonehead dinosaurs. They've got these bony structures, even storage chambers in them. What if they stored chemicals like the bombardier beetle has? They could mix them together in this combustion tube, does a U-turn at the top, go right out its nostril, poof, you'd have fire. I'm not saying this is Leviathan. I'm simply saying we have the same makeup that a beetle has today in the fossil record. If a beetle can do it, a dinosaur ought to be able to, so I would say something blew fire called Leviathan. It's not a scientific impossibility. You see, there are all kinds of things that produce fire. I mean, some things you just stick it in water, it starts on fire, like sodium. I have here some hydrogen. Hydrogen's a flammable gas. Interestingly, the evolutionists say that hydrogen is where the Big Bang all came from. Yeah, they really can't tell you where hydrogen really came from. It doesn't, at least not without breaking scientific laws. I have here a thing of soap water here. I'm going to try and make some bubbles. To show you the Big Bang. Actually, it's really not going to be too much of a Big Bang, but you can see here that I've got bubbles with hydrogen, and like I said, hydrogen is a very flammable gas. See? But they're saying that that's what happened, is the Big Bang happened from that. Pretty impressive, huh? Actually, if I stick oxygen in there, mix oxygen, it is a pretty big bang for sure. But again, oxygen for life can't be in the early atmosphere, but yet they know it was, so they just kind of, it's convenient, like in the Miller-Urey experiment, to show that there was no oxygen in their recipe to make amino acids, and they made the wrong ones anyway. But hydrogen is lighter than air. So, it likes to float, too, okay? And it is kind of fun to play with. Let me do that one more time since my other one kind of disappeared on me. I love the sound of this. I feel like a mad scientist. Come on. Yeah. So, all right. Is there one adult that would like to try this? Just to, you want to try it? Come on. Come on up. Let's try it. One of the things I like to teach, go ahead and just dip your hand in there. I like to get his hand wet. Here's one of the things we like to tell you. Do you know all you got to do is get your hand wet. I'm going to get you some good bubbles here. God has made this planet have water on it for a reason. Water absorbs heat in a very tremendous way. Do you know that if we did not have the oceans and lakes on the earth, we would fry, we'd be crispy critters. You can actually take a water balloon and boil it by sticking a match under it and let that flame touch the mat. You can boil water in a water balloon. It won't pop the balloon because it keeps taking the heat away from the balloon into the water. And so that's why I have him dip his hand in there to get it wet. Go ahead and just scoop a bunch up like that. There we go. And just hold your hand out flat, and boom.
Cool.
There. Are you sure?
Cool.
You're only going to be able to have one chance to do this, you know. There you go. Go ahead and dip your hand in that water. Just get your hand wet. And then go ahead, and I'll get you some more here if you want. Go ahead and scoop some of those up. Now, it's a little scary because you can feel just a little bit of heat, but not much. See? All right, so this is, again, where we get the Big Bang from hydrogen, supposedly. So anyway, there are things that can blow fire. There are things that can do that, that certainly animals can have that could create it. Things that can cause sparks or increased oxygen to, when it meets the oxygen, you have an ignition. So not scientifically impossible at all. Kind of sounds a little bit like a dragon, doesn't it? What we've been talking about, blowing fire, scales, all that. Well, guess what? Dragon is a word that was around when the Bible was translated into English, and dragons are all over the place in Scripture. Yeah. Genesis 1:21 says, God created great sea creatures, whales, or monsters. The Hebrew word is tenin, translated as dragon throughout Scripture. We see dragons in Isaiah 43:20. They're there in Jeremiah 14:6. We've got them here in Isaiah 27, the dragon that's in the sea. Psalms even talks about a dragon that's in the waters. Could that be something like a chronosaur or a plesiosaur type creature? Sure. Yeah, not a problem. How about the flying serpent of Isaiah 30? Could that be something like a pterodactyl or a pteranodon? Why not? Another thing we're putting in our museum is a 1946 dictionary. You take a 1946 Webster's Collegiate Dictionary, go look up the word dragon. The first definition, now rare. 1946, they knew dragons were still around, but today we've just kind of mythologically, you know, made them disappear. Did dinosaurs go on Noah's Ark? Well, to save some time, God said take two of every kind of animal on the boat. A dinosaur is a kind of animal, is it not? They got on the boat, they got off of the boat. If they were alive today, I think they'd be making t-shirts. They went on the boat. Okay. Well, like I described this morning, I won't go through this in great detail again, but bottom line is, even Billy Graham, when he was asked if dinosaurs go on the ark, he says no, because they were dead by the time God created the garden. Again, like I said this morning, you can't have something dying if man isn't there to sin, to bring death. It destroys the purpose and meaning of death, destroying the meaning of Jesus' death. That's new to you, ask me afterwards. But I think most of you were here for the service, and so I won't go through that again. But they say, how could dinosaurs fit? They'd be too big. Well, you don't realize how big Noah's Ark is. It's a huge boat. It's big enough to take 522 railroad cars on it. Each one of those could hold 240 sheep. Now, we know that a kind, based on genetic studies, is closest to a family in our classification. That means two of every kind of the 938, only 4% of the ark would be filled with animals, leaving the other 96% for the eight people and the supplies that went along. There is plenty of room on this boat to take dinosaurs. Houses fit in there, so dinosaurs aren't going to have a problem. It's a big boat. Well, what's the average size of a dinosaur? If I took all the bones of all the dinosaurs in all the world that have ever been found, what's the average size of a dinosaur? I'll tell you what evolutionists are saying. Chicken to sheep size. Yeah. Well, how come you thought they were so big? Well, some are big, but hardly any of them Think about it. Did you know most reptiles today, as long as they live, never stop growing? So the oldest alligator of its kind is the biggest one of its kind? If dinosaurs were reptiles and they were living 900 years like humans were before the flood, well, then they'd grow for 900 years. See, I think this one is just a bigger one of these. That's it. Understanding that God wanted to take animals on the ark so that when they got off of the ark, they're going to have babies and fill the earth again. Is God going to take the huge, old, worn-out dinosaur, grandma and grandpa, to have babies? No, he's going to take a younger, smaller, healthier teenager that's going to have lots of kids when it gets off the boat. So even though a big one would fit on the boat, I doubt he took a big one on the boat. And out of all these dinosaurs that they keep giving different names to, they probably aren't different. They're the same thing, just different stages of life. Here's a baby growing up getting its horns. And then as an adult, maybe something like that starts growing around the outside. We've been saying this for over 30 years as creationists, and just in the last five, evolutionists are starting to say the same thing. I mean, think about it. If you found these in the fossil record and they weren't alive today, you think they'd give them the same name? Not a chance. Horns do weird things. Teeth, you have like wisdom teeth. They come in later. Same thing happens with animals. So not as many dinosaurs as they tell you there are. What happened to the dinosaurs? Well, first of all, I want you to understand that just because something has sharp teeth doesn't mean that you're mean or that you eat meat. Okay, but I ask kids all the time, what was on T-Rex's menu? And they're like, I know. It ain't meat. Why? Because look at those teeth. Those teeth have to be for eating meat. No, those teeth would be great to eat a big old pumpkin or a cantaloupe, especially the ones we find in the fossil record. Yeah. Sharp teeth does not mean eat meat. I mean, look at this guy. What do you think he eats? Anything he wants to, right? Actually, only eats leaves. Still alive today, so I could tell you that. We've observed it. But if this was not alive today and they found it in the fossil record, you know they'd be making horror movies out of it. You know, I'd be going, Problem is, it'd have to be a Veggie Tale horror movie. You know, Bob the Tomato. Run, Larry, run! Doesn't eat meat. How about this? The fruit bat. It has sharp teeth. Doesn't eat meat. Just eats fruit. We have this cousin of the piranha. Just eats seeds that fall into the water. Razor sharp teeth, though. We have things like the panda bear, koala bear. They don't eat meat. They have sharp teeth. But it's for bamboo. We have this ferocious creature. Ooh, scary. The Chinese water deer. Yeah. You see, it's bad science to say sharp teeth means eat meat. It may be true in general that sharp teeth means that you can eat meat, but there's a lot of animals that have sharp teeth that don't. You don't have sharp teeth. Why do you eat meat? Because it's good. Yeah. All right. So the other thing is just because you have sharp teeth doesn't mean that you're mean. When Noah gets off the ark, read your Bible carefully. It says this. God said, "Now I will put the fear of man into the animal." The relationship you and I have today with animals didn't come about till after the flood. Prior to that, it seems like they were nice. So if you want to know what happened to the dinosaurs, I think it's a combination of things. Number one, I think that the harsher climates after the flood were tough on them. The ice age happening and so on that we talked about. Number two, I think that they were hunted for sport, just like you'd hunt a big deer today. I mean, who of you hunters out there wouldn't be trying to bag a big T-Rex to hang on your wall? If your wife would let you put it there. Which we know that ain't happening. Okay. And the third thing is, I think they were delicious. Because God also said this to Noah when he gets off the ark. Now I give you permission to eat meat. I think those dinosaurs said, "Hey, we're meat." And Noah said, "I know." I mean, think of the drumsticks on those babies, you know? And the fourth thing is, I think they were freaking people out. I don't care if it was a 1 foot tall T-Rex that came into my yard. I'd kill it. That'd freak me out. I'm not a reptile fan. And even if I thought it was cool, my wife would make me kill it. And that's exactly what we see happening through history. And now, by the way, we have found partially fossilized dinosaur bones many times with blood cells still in them. blood cells. Guys, try to be as unbiased as possible. It's impossible to be unbiased, but try to. Do you really think that finding blood cells in dinosaur bones that are supposed to be 65 million years old, that those blood cells could last that long? Is this evidence of a young Earth, or dinosaurs at least dying in a more recent past, or millions of years ago? Yeah, there is no way blood cells could last 65 million years. It just isn't happening. Well, people write me letters from all around the world. They say, you're a sponge brain idiot. That's a quote. They say, you've got to believe in evolution. Look at Darwin's finches. Some had big beaks, some had little beaks. That is evolution. No, it's not evolution. Look around you. Some of you have big beaks, some of you have little beaks. That's what we call a variation among a species, variety among a kind. And it can be illustrated here through looking at a jar of marbles. We're going to say this jar of marbles represents a full gene pool in the original dog kind of animal. Full jar of marbles, full gene pool. We'll say it was a wolf for the dog kind. If I would reach into that jar of marbles and rearrange the same information, mix them up, I could get a coyote. If I reach into that jar of marbles, take some out, lose genetic information, I could get the fox. Take some more out, get the Great Dane. Take some more out till you have hardly anything left in this dumb animal. And you get the poodle. Okay. Point being, it's rearranging information. It's losing information. But at no point in time can I take a marble out of my cat jar, stick it into my dog jar, hopefully getting a half cat, half dog dat, because my jar would break. It's fatal. Can't happen. But this is what evolution requires to be true. To add new information into a species and increase its complexity. We've never done that in nature. We've never done it in a laboratory. But it's a requirement for evolution to be true. Instead, when the Bible says things reproduce after their kind, that is all we see happening. What's a kind? Something that can reproduce after itself. For example, rabbits are known for how much they reproduce. Here was Noah on the ark, I'm sure. Noah, you've been a naughty rabbit. I'm only supposed to have two. You would think out of all of these rabbits that have been born, billions of them, just once, we should have found a Cabot out there somewhere. But we haven't. We only find rabbits reproducing after their rabbit kind. Now, in Nebraska, we do crazy stuff with corn, but we've never gotten a corn cob and a banana peel that looks like a watermelon. Just corn. Different sizes and colors of kernels of corn. We have crossed a zebra and a horse. That gave us a zorse. A zebra and a donkey gave us a zonkey. I think that means a horse and a donkey going to give us a honky, but I'm not sure. The point being is God did not have to take a zebra, a horse, and a donkey on Noah's ark. He only had to take the original horse kind, and from them we get the variety we have today. You can put the stripes on, you can leave the stripes off, you can get them in between, but it's still a horse kind. You never have something like this happening, do you? No. But if evolution is true, we should. In the dog, we've messed them up. We've bred the brains right out of them. Look what we've done to these dumb dogs. Oh, I know, you think that's cute. I'm sorry, that's worthless, okay? A little 4-inch dog. What do you do with it? You put it down, it starts to shake because it knows it's about to die. A cat! I'm a hawk! Worthless. You see these girls walking around with them in their purses and they're all proud of this thing. It's like, what are you proud of? Your purse stinks, you know? All right, to be fair for you dog lovers, though, I am told that this little 4-inch dog can kill a Great Dane, one of those big dogs. Yeah, he gets caught in their throat, chokes to death. And you never find this happening, do you? No, and we're still waiting for the watch fog, but that hasn't happened either. I'll tell you something, guys. I am so glad evolution is not true. Can you imagine how scary it would be for you women to have babies? I hope this one doesn't have fins. Really? Especially if you lived in Arkansas? Whoa! You could have a bunch of hillbillies running around. Half Hillary, half Bill. And that doesn't happen either. Anyway, I want to show you some evidences that dinosaurs did live with human beings, guys. Now, I could give you an hour of this stuff alone. There is that much. I'm going to try and give you 10, 15 minutes. It is amazing. We've got a book on the table called Dire Dragons back there that'll show you stuff from all around the world, and that doesn't even cover it all. We have found the Ica stones. In 1535, the Spanish conquistadors went over to Ecuador or Peru, and they saw these stones, and they talked about these strange creatures on these rocks that were engraved. And there are thousands of these things. Here it looks just like what we would call today a triceratops, or maybe a unicorn. Here we see what looks like a T-Rex. Now, one thing I'd like to point out is, see those little circles on there? Kind of interesting. Why did they put those circles on there? Well, we'll get to that here in a bit. Here's another, this is some cave art. Interestingly, the Bible tells us in Leviticus 11 about clean and unclean animals, and it talks about these fowls, these birds that walk on all four. Now, that doesn't fit our modern classification, so if you look at many of the modern translations, this is insects today. Go look in the King James, it's fowls, but you see, didn't fit the modern classification, so it must be insects. No, I think that there were birds that we have found in the fossil record, like dinosaurs, pterodactyls, that would walk on all four. Not only that, we have this Ica stone that's interesting because, look, it's nursing their young. Lamentation talks about the sea monster that nurses the young. Again, that doesn't fit our modern classification, but here in the Ica stone we see them nursing the young. If I was going to make some forgery, I certainly wouldn't do that. And by the way, there's calcite that is built up over top of these engravings, showing them to be old, not recent. Okay. Here's one riding a dinosaur being led by a rope. If they weren't mean before Noah's flood, I'd have tried pterodactyl airlines. Okay. Lots of them that we could show you. Here's an urn from Turkey. This is from 530 BC. Notice the ears on this thing. Got some small horns, it looks like, and then big ears. I want you to notice those ears because you're going to see a lot of these from around the world that have big ears. I would say that because we didn't see dinosaurs in what we're putting in our museums today, we just didn't know that, so they don't fossilize, so they're not putting it in there. Here's the Narmer palette. I've got a cast of this for our museum. The Narmer palette is from Egypt, 2000 B.C., Now, this is in many of our secular art books in universities today. But the interesting thing is, you know what they say it is in the textbooks? Two men training lions. Weird lions. I'd say it looks more like a dinosaur. But again, they can't admit that dinosaurs lived with people. We have as well, the sides of this mask look like a stegosaurus. The handles of this vessel look like some dinosaurs. We have the Han Dynasty. This is from 206 BC to 220 AD. We find a number of these bronze sculptures looking like dinosaurs, some that look just like a velociraptor. In the Han Dynasty, we have this, or the Zhao Dynasty, I mean, from 5 to 600 BC, this vessel. Now, what's interesting is here they have what look like scales. This is fossilized dinosaur skin that looks just like it. We have found this in the fossil record. They have made that out of it, which is very similar to that. We also have a Hindu temple from the 12th century. On the doors of this temple right here, you go there. This is in Cambodia. You see what looks like a gazelle, a baboon, an ostrich, and looks just like a stegosaurus to me, but do you know what they say it is? It's an animal standing in front of a flower. I'm not kidding. That's what they say. Again, folks, every piece of scientific evidence has to be interpreted. If you don't believe the Bible and you believe in millions of years, you got to explain this some other way. In Israel, if you've ever been to Israel, I don't know if you've gone to Sepori. It's a town right next to Nazareth. It was being built when Jesus was a boy. In there, there's a home, and it's probably got a 20-foot by 30-foot mosaic floor. And they've got a big, what they call the Mona Lisa of the Middle East, because the eyes of this woman follow you wherever you go. Way back in the corner on the floor, is this picture here. Looks like a guy throwing a rock at a dinosaur. I've got it blown up here, but that's the picture there you can see. Notice the ears again. We have, this just kind of gives you an idea how our interpretation of science changes. In 1852, this is what Megalosaurus looked like in our museums. 1859, he looked like that. Today, he looks like this. So, again, we're constantly finding new stuff and different interpretations and whatnot. So, like I said, for them to have ears is not a stretch of the imagination at all. This is some stuff in Mexico, kind of hard to see, but he outlines this thing with chalk at night. It glows in the dark. You see exactly what it looks like there. You have what it looks very similar to some of what we have in our museums. This is a Mayan mural here inside this temple. They've got this picture. Here it is. I'm going to blow this area up. It's kind of hard to see in this light, but he's got a head mask on. Looks just like a dinosaur. Ears on it again. Very similar to what we have in our museums. 30,000 pre-Columbian artifacts taken out of here. One of them here, this shows a guy, he's got a hat on, he's fishing on a boat. And he's got this animal on his hat, on his head. Here's a close-up of it. It looks just like what we would call a protoceratops today. You know what, could I have you maybe hit these lights? I think it's light enough that people can see, and they might be able to see this stuff better, maybe. We also have this one here from Peru about 550 years ago. This looks just like a very young pteranodon. We've got this textile cloth, dinosaurs on it. Again, see those little circles? Those circles are interesting because you want to see some fossilized dinosaur skin? Look at that big circle. Maybe that's why we're seeing these circles on some of these things, because they had those big circular things on their scales in some cases. Makes sense. Like I said, I could do an hour of this stuff alone. Here's this castle in France from the 1500s. Now, many kings, they all had kind of an emblem, kind of like a mascot for their school, you know. Different ones had different emblems. Francois here, his was this. They call it a salamander. Okay, here's King Louis the 12th. He had a porcupine. You know, different ones had different things. But Francois here had this salamander, they say. That's a strange-looking salamander blowing fire, but it's what they say it is, because, again, it can't be a dinosaur. Now, here's a fire salamander today. Notice the legs go outside, not underneath it like what Francois had. He has, in that castle, there are 800 depictions, more than 800 depictions of what we would call dinosaurs. Some of them have different types of scales. Okay? Salamanders don't have scales either. We have, let's see here, skip some things to get to. This is an interesting one here from Spain, from the 1600s. See this guy, he's got this kind of really sharp-toothed dinosaur here. Let me show you what we found in the fossil record that looks just like what we see on our artistic walls here. Fossil record. That is the picture. Almost identical, isn't it? Okay, in Africa, this tribe is known for their artwork in wood and metal. Looks just like what we would have in our museums today. We have in China, these pendants look just like what we would call our dinosaurs today. Again, I could just go on and on and on and on here. Even in America, in the Grand Canyon, they have this here. Looks just like a dinosaur. National Bridges Monument in Utah has something that they say resembles a dinosaur. I'd say it looks just like one. Here it is. Zooming in closer. We'll take away the outline. I'd say people lived with dinosaurs, folks. There's just so much evidence of it. Here's a 4th century mosaic in England. Long-necked dinosaurs. Ooh, look at those ears again. They even show the behavior that we see long-necked giraffes doing today. They call that necking when they wrap their necks around each other, and they're doing the same thing here. Here's Bishop Bell's tomb from Carlisle Cathedral. Okay, this here from the 1496 period. Long-necked dinosaurs. Now notice one has bumps on the tail, the other does not. And we have found both in the fossil record, some that don't have it, and some that do. I'd say people lived with dinosaurs. I mean, there's stuff in Kuwait, all around the world. Marco Polo said that the Chinese emperor raised dragons to pull their chariots in parades. Alexander the Great said that his men killed a dragon in a cave in 326 BC. So, like I said, there's stuff from all over the world. And yet, we have the gall to say that dinosaurs didn't live with people. A Chinese restaurant, I think, has evidence that dinosaurs live with people. You mean they have one of these for every month of the year? You mean they just threw one in that didn't exist? Yeah, no, dinosaurs live with people. Now, obviously, it's too many things to say that, well, there was a, animal standing in front of a flower and all that. So what else do they say? Well, when the mammals were evolving, they were having nightmares about the dinosaurs. And that has been passed on through our DNA as you evolved. So these cavemen and the people that saw these things and drew them on caves had nightmares of dinosaurs that was passed on through their DNA, and now they're drawing it on cave art. You got to come up with something. So, the Hell Creek Formation in Montana, do you know almost all the bones there stink? Smell like rotting flesh? You really think that stink, the smell, the scents are going to last 65 million years? I don't think so. Matter of fact, when you carbon date dinosaur bones, first of all the carbon should have been gone millions of years ago. But the carbon, they date to be in the 30,000 range. Most of the dinosaurs we date, 30 to 34,000. Why? Well, first of all, carbon dating, by the way, is dependent upon the amount of C14 in our atmosphere. You know where we get it from? The radiation of the sun bombarding nitrogen turns the nitrogen into carbon-14. Well, if we had that firmament that we talked about before, protecting you from the radiation, the nitrogen in the atmosphere doesn't get turned into carbon-14. So anything that died in the flood is going to give an older age than what it really was. So I don't believe that it's 34,000 years old, but it would explain why you get an older date. Okay? And there's a lot of other things with the dating methods, but I'm not going to get into that today. Even the figs and things like that, some of the fruit that's fossilized from the Hell Creek Formation, they've sent it into a lab to analyze it, and guess what? The chemicals that give it the stink are still measurable. It smells citrusy, fruity. So, I would say that if we find fresh bones, that we're finding elastic, stretchable bones, and we're finding the presence of carbon in there, that they still smell, and there's artwork and historical records, I would say the evidence points to an Earth that's younger, or at least dinosaurs living in a more recent period. Hard to argue with that. There's even fossil evidence of man and dinosaurs living together. I probably won't talk much about that, but we do find very large things in the fossil record. We find saber-toothed tigers that stood about 6 feet tall, found with dinosaurs and humans, by the way. Now, we find insects that are large, too. Now, the interesting aspect there is that why? Well, do you know that more atmospheric pressure and more oxygen causes insects to get larger? So again, that supports that whole canopy theory again. We have found cockroaches in the fossil record that are a foot long. Really have. 18 inches in some cases. Our textbooks tell us this. I'm not making it up. Why? Well, because we lived in a different world before the flood. We have spiders here. There's a quarter for scale. It's in the Denver Museum. dragonflies, some with 5-foot wingspans. Again, textbooks tell us this stuff. I'm not making it up. Grasshoppers as big as cats. Buffalo with 12-foot horn spans. Cattails standing 60 feet tall. My daughter can't even get her arms around the fossils of them. Huge things in the fossil record. 400-pound beavers. Centipedes 6 to 8 feet long. Lots of large things, even oysters way up in the mountains. I think I know where God got the pearly gates. Now, wait a minute. Oysters, they don't live in the mountains. And not only that, but you see how it's closed up like this? He's laying across it, but see, it's closed. That's how we find them in the fossil record. Closed, the animal's still in it. Today, when something dies and falls to the bottom of the lake, right? When something dies, the muscles relax and they open up. This speaks of rapid burial. This speaks of Noah's flood. Okay. We even find huge humans. We have found the Roman Emperor Maximinus was 8'6". There's a 12-foot tall skeleton of a human being found in California and also in Arizona. So there are large humans as well. Now I show people this and they go, oh, that can't be true because this is a thigh bone of a human. From the knee to the hip, this man stood about 14 feet tall, they estimate. And again, like I said, that can't be true. Why? Because you're not thinking biblically. There were giants, weren't there? Yeah, Goliath. Goliath stood almost 10 feet tall. By the way, this is a hoax in case you get emails of that. That's not true. That's Photoshop. We have Robert Wadlow. Okay, here he is pictured with his brothers. Goliath was almost 10 foot tall. He was 9 foot tall. But Goliath wasn't the only large one. Goliath had 4 brothers. I think that's why David picked up 5 stones. Because he was sending the Philistines a message. Your whole family is dead. Your giants are gone. And the Bible records each one of those giants being wiped out by the Israelites. And they were all the brothers of Goliath. 2 Samuel 21 talks about one that Abishai killed. We see Lami here in 1 Chronicles 20, verse 5, a 6-fingered giant here, 24 fingers and toes. By the way, in archaeology, my DVD on archaeology in the Bible, we'll show you that we have positively identified Gath in archaeology. And they found in Gath the name on a pottery, Goliath. Not only that, but they found a clay statue that had 6 fingers on each hand and 6 toes. And these guys were from Gath. So, just neat to see archaeology supporting Scripture in that way. So there were large people as well. The Bible even says the sons of God married the daughters of men and giants roamed the earth. I don't have time to talk about this fully today, but the bottom line is there were giants. And this verse here has a lot to do with the whole idea about aliens. Could there be aliens? Life on outer space planets? Think biblically. If you think there are aliens on other planets, then get my DVD, Do Aliens Exist? We'll clear it up for you to understand what that's all about. We have found a hammer, wood handle right here, the iron head in Cretaceous rock. That means found with dinosaurs. Unless dinosaurs are making hammers, I'd say people lived with dinosaurs. And this is iron and chlorine mixed together. We cannot do that today. It's like oil and water. They don't mix. Now, we can do it on a microscopic scale, but not the whole thing like this was done. We don't know how they did it, which is pretty fascinating. One man at NASA said, if we could understand this, we could revolutionize metallurgy because it's iron and it doesn't rust. Yeah, does not rust. We don't know why or how exactly. We can't reproduce it. But they did it. It doesn't surprise me because the Bible says right there in Genesis chapter 4, verse 22, that Tubal Cain made all kinds of tools out of bronze and iron. Right there at the beginning, God gave us the wisdom for agriculture, horticulture, music, metallurgy, right from the start. God gave us the intelligence. Since 1829, we have measured the electromagnetic field of the Earth. It has declined by 7%. That means at that rate of decay, you go back in time, it gets more, right? At that rate, you go back just 100,000 years, you'd have an electromagnetic field of a neutron star, and the Earth would collapse in on itself. That means the Earth can't even be 100,000 years old, let alone the 4.6 billion they're trying to tell you it is. And there are so many common sense things like this. My DVD, Scientific Evidences of a Young Earth, will give you lots of them. For example, the moon. The moon is moving away from us 3.8 centimeters every year. NASA says that. Okay, we'll just say 4 centimeters. That means 5 years ago, the moon was 20 centimeters closer. All right, 6,000 years ago, it was like 600 or 700 miles closer. Not a big deal at all. But you go back just a few million years ago, and the moon is touching the Earth. Maybe that's what happened to the dinosaurs, at least the tall ones. They got mooned. Huh. No, there's no way that it can be as old as what they're saying. And like I said, so many things like that, the amount of helium in the Earth and all kinds of things. That electromagnetic field is declining by 7%. So you go back 6,000 years, you'd have a very good electromagnetic field. It would be increased by about 10 Gauss. Well, what's interesting about that is if I would get bit by a rattlesnake, I could take this here, it's a stun gun, and I could zap myself. Let's say I got bit on the wrist. I could take this thing here, zap myself, again perpendicular, third time because it felt good, and go home. Because rattlesnake venom is proteins and enzymes chemically bonded together. Electricity breaks the chemical bond. It allows your body to take in the protein, and it's good for you. Now, I'm going to show you that this is not going to kill you, okay? Now, I said you wanted to be a volunteer, right? I wouldn't. I'm not going to zap you. You really want to be zapped by a stun gun? No? I'll do it to myself. If I would get bit, I'd stick it here on the wrist. I would get ready. Now, before I do this, I want you to understand that I don't want any Einsteins going home, he did 36,000, I can do 110. Bad idea. Low amps, high amps. DC current, AC current. Life, death, possibly. Okay, you will not hear click, click. Click, click goes inside of me. You're going to either hear a high-pitched hum coming out of this or a high-pitched squeal coming out of this. Okay? I would stick it here by my bite. I would get ready and zap. It's going to leave a couple of red marks, but it's not going to kill you. Okay? 36,000. This has actually been modified down to 36,000 from 65,000. But I've been doing this a lot of years, and it hasn't affected me a bit. Okay. Just kidding. Anyway, point being, as you go back 6,000 years, it would be a very good world. As a matter of fact, do you know that the June and July issue of Outdoor Life 1988, there's 11 pages dedicated to this where a farmer gets stung by a bee, allergic to bee stings. His chest begins to tighten up. He trips over the electric fence, and he feels fine because he gets zapped. Doesn't have to go to the hospital. Dog gets bit by a rattlesnake, so they hook it up to the jumper cables of a car. Dog's fine. Okay, I don't know if it comes to the same name or not, but it's fine. That's cool and all, but not the most credible source. That's why I also have up here the Oklahoma State Medical Journal, which says that this is a legitimate thing. It works. Because rattlesnake venom is proteins and enzymes chemically bonded together. The electricity breaks the bond, so your body actually can take in the good part, and it doesn't deteriorate the flesh. Here's a rattlesnake, or the snake, they're basically going to milk the thing, okay? And so they take it on the balloon, it bites the balloon, which causes the venom to go into the cup. They then take the venom and stick it in a syringe, and they take that syringe and put the venom in some pig's blood. Just to show you what it does to blood. It then coagulates. Within seconds, so if you zap that venom before doing that, it does not do that. So, prior to Noah's flood, we may not have even been harmed by a bite of such a thing. Maybe it would even help you, okay? We have found batteries near the pyramids as well. Batteries. They produced about 1.5 volts. Mythbusters even had this thing on. It's called the Baghdad battery. They had electricity. You see, they're pretty smart. But evolution teaches us that the further back we go, the dumber you are. You old people here know that's not true. You can already see how far we've fallen. I mean, today, I mean, if your cash register breaks at McDonald's, good luck for getting change for a buck, right? Yeah. Scientists say we use about 10 to 15% of our brains today. If that's true, I figure I'm operating on about 6 to 8. I'm not joking either. Did you notice that I took my watch off before I zapped myself with 36,000 volts? Only took me 3 watches to figure that out. I think Adam would have had it figured out right away. But see, we are getting dumber, and science even supports us. Stanford is showing that we're losing our intellect every generation, just genetically. I think Adam probably used all of his brain, though. Even if Adam only used 10 to 15% of it, I think he used it to its full capacity. We have these people called savants. I don't know if you ever saw the movie Rain Man. He was a savant. I'm not going to show you this whole video, but bottom line is, Rain Man was a savant. This man could read what it would take you 23 minutes to read. He read in 53 seconds. Part of the reason, one eye read one page, the other eye read the other page at the same time. And he had like a 90, almost 99% recall of every letter, page, comma on it. Photographic memory. You could ask him any question, he could answer it. You say, I was born on June 23rd, 1942. He'd say, you were born on a Friday. This year it's going to be a Tuesday. Just that fast. Just an amazing thing. Scientists said a portion of his brain worked at its full capacity while the rest of it didn't function very well. He couldn't put his own coat or socks on by himself. What if Adam had 10% of his brain working to its full capacity? Let alone maybe having all of his brain working. I think, frankly, we use more than 10 to 15% of our brain. I'm just using their facts. But anyway, it's amazing. How'd they move stones that our world's largest cranes combined can't move? I don't know, but we're smarter. Doesn't even make sense, does it? Well, we've got the computer. Yeah, we need it. A couple of technologies have allowed us to do a lot more. And I think they may have had some of that stuff. I mean, there's some interesting things. Here, these look like little brooches, they say, of insects, because they can't be airplanes because it's 1,000 years old. Yet they took an airplane, took one of these things, scale model of it, they put an engine in the thing because it's got ailerons and rudders, and it flies perfectly. But it's long before the Wright brothers. There's a lot of evidence to suggest that the ancients could fly. Okay, I don't know for sure. It's just a weird evidence. We've got the geoglyphs. You have to be up in the mountains to see, or not in the mountains because there aren't any to get up on to see it. You have to be up in an airplane or a hot air balloon to see these things. Why would they do it if you couldn't see them? Not only that, but we have the Babylonian law book called Halkatha from 2400 BC. It says to operate a flying machine is a great privilege. Knowledge of flying is a gift of the gods of old for saving lives. I don't know what that means. I'm just telling you what's there. We've got this Indian Shastra. It's a sacred writing. They say this thing flew. The Chinese emperor Shun is said to have constructed a flying apparatus and a parachute. Chang Tang had a flying chariot made by an inventor. I don't know. Look at this. In Egypt, the Temple of Osiris. Here it is. I've got it blown up here. What's that look like? Yeah, it looks like a helicopter. I'm not saying it is. I don't know. All I know is that these people were very intelligent. Much smarter. They weren't sitting around fire. Woman! They were smart. And archaeology shows us that over and over. Analog computers that have been found. Reproducing it, they think that it was something to reproduce, or used for astronomy, to track the stars. We have the blues. The Egyptians copied the blues from a stone. That took complex chemistry, and yet they did that. We know that they did textiles of different colors. They had music. They did brain surgery called trepanning, and many people survived because the bones grew back. We know that they did amputations without infections. We know what looked like spark plugs have been found, nanotechnology. I mean, we could go on and on and on of the amazing things that are found. Even art is hilarious. I mean, I think art's proof we're not evolving. You know, art used to be art. Now it's like, you know, art. You go to these rest areas and universities and you see these sculptures of something. I don't know what it is. A big pole going through a, you know, a big square and a ball standing on top of that. And it's like, preschool, I learned those shapes way back then. Art. Modern paintings. You know, Leonardo da Vinci was known as being one of his the most famous for his anatomical correctness. They've discovered cave art. When they did studies on it here, they discovered cave art was actually more accurate anatomically than Leonardo da Vinci was. Pretty amazing. Adolf Hitler says, you tell a lie long enough, loud enough, and often enough, people will believe it. The lie of evolution, I believe, has been taught long enough, loud enough, and often enough, and people have believed it. It is time that we stand firmly on God's word as our source of truth, and that we do not allow ourselves for the culture and propaganda of interpreted science to interpret our scripture. Stand on the Bible and trust in Him, because He is Lord of Lords, King of Kings, the Word that became flesh and dwelt among us. So, well, guys, I want to thank you so much for coming. And if you have more questions, I'll be happy to take them. But I don't want to keep you here too long if you've got things going on. I don't know when the game started. Did I hear the Vikings were playing or something? Two? Noon. Oh, I love you guys. You know, this had never happened in Nebraska or Wisconsin. I'm just saying, you know, it's great. As you heard last night, you know, we always hear sports builds character. That is the biggest lie ever. Sports does not build character. The NFL and the NBA would be teeming with it. God's word builds character. And you guys have chosen the better today. So not to say you can't watch them and enjoy them. I'm all for that. You chose well. So God bless you for that. All right. Thank you so much.